Thank you. Let's go ahead and get started. I'm really excited to come to Tech Ed. I've never been to a Tech Ed show before. I've been to other Microsoft shows before. But before I go ahead and deep dive into the whole sequencing process, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about myself. My name is Alvin Chardon. I'm a senior software developer engineer in test, working for the AppV team. I've been in Microsoft about 9 years now. I started off fresh out of college, joined the Visual C++ compiler team, and worked on the front end for a good 3 years, language stuff, syntax. Then I moved on to the IDE, the Integrated Development Environment, and I worked on some features. Thank you. Features like IntelliSense and browsing and these things. So when you hit a little dot and you get a drop down, I had a little bit of part in that. When you hit the dot or the arrow and nothing comes out, I also had a little bit of my hands in that. And then about 3 years ago, I joined the AppV team. And AppV is a great product. So who is out there? Can I see a show of hands who's using AppV right now? Well, nice. Are there any leftover legacy guys that know what SoftGrid is? Some SoftGrid guys. OK. So even before SoftGrid, which was the precursor to the Microsoft Application Virtualization product, there was another product called SoftwareWOW. And in SoftwareWOW, this whole concept of packaging an application to virtualize this has evolved a lot over time. And what I want to talk to you guys about today is about the most recent investments we've done in the sequencer, which is the application we call to package the virtual applications. Really exciting stuff. So I'm going to be concentrating around all the new features that we put in the 4.6 SP1 sequencer. They're all centered around a concise, good user experience that takes our best practices, and instead of just sort of recommending best practices, we actually took the best practices and we shoved it into the system so that we walk the sequencer engineer through the best practices with the whole user experience. So I'm going to talk about how this new sequencer can make you more effective, and also discuss a little bit about the best practices. For the sake of time, if you guys have any questions, let's leave the majority of them to the end. But then if you have any questions around the stuff I'm doing during the demos, it's OK to go in and raise your hand and do a question. There's microphones around the room so that other people can hear what you're asking about. So this whole focus on the sequencer for AppV 4.6 SP1, we did it around four pillars. The first of our pillars was diagnostics. We wanted the sequencer to help you preemptively diagnose what could possibly go wrong with this packaging of a virtual application. We also center around ease of use. So for example, one of our complex technologies, dynamic suite composition, which I'm going to go into details later, basically taking a bunch of packages and creating dependencies amongst them. I'm going to show you how the new workflows in the sequencer help you go through this complex feature in a snap. Also, predictability. We're going to talk about package accelerators, and I have a demo for that as well. I love package accelerators. It's a brand new feature that's meant to accelerate how you create packages, and I'm going to go into a lot of details later. And then in the end, I want to talk a little bit about some of the automation features that we've actually built into the system to help you streamline more of your sequencing processes. I don't have a demo for that one, but I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the technologies. So, I noticed that maybe a quarter of the room didn't raise their hands when we talked about AppV. So I want to pause a little bit and walk you through the AppV value proposition and what AppV is for those people that are not familiar with the product. The whole AppV system was built around two core technologies. Technology number one is the virtualization of applications. And what that means is that we take applications, we inspect everything that it wants to lay down on the operating system. Files in the file system, keys and values in the registry, fonts, comma objects, all these sorts of things. And we create virtual versions of them that we package together with the app. So this creates a package that helps large enterprises be able to streamline the process of delivering these applications into the users in a non-obtrusive, isolated way. So applications are protected against each other, and also the operating system is protected against changes that these apps want to do at runtime. So this lowers the cost of application deployment and testing for enterprises. The second core functionality and technology that we have in AppV is streaming. So we will take this package and we will stream the bits over the network, like if it were a video file or if it were a web app. So we take all these good characteristics of web apps that are always up to date, they're delivered as a service, and we bring it to the classic desktop class applications. So around streaming, this gives you easier management of your applications. AppV comes with its own management server, so you can do your user-based entitlement of applications and manage licenses and things like that. But we also integrate with other ESD, electronic software distribution systems, like Microsoft System Center Configuration Manager, which I know a lot of people have already deployed out there. So the value proposition, applications are isolated. They're delivered as a service, like web apps, but they're rich, full client desktop apps. And then we have centralized management and servicing for your applications. So that's kind of the value proposition for AppV. So let's get back into the sequencer. First, let's talk about diagnostics. And what are diagnostics? It's basically a way for us to help tell you what went wrong. Before we jump into the demo, I'd like to talk a little bit about the number one question that customers always bring to us. Which applications are good candidates for virtualization? How do I know? Well, the rule of thumb, and in general, is that almost all applications are really good candidates. Now, I'm not going to lie to you. There's some applications that are harder than others to virtualize. There's a category of applications that are require a little bit more of your time to be able to deploy a successful package. But we have best practices around those, and I'm going to show you how the sequencer diagnostics help you preemptively deal with these things instead of reactively after a failure of deployment. So what categories are troublesome for virtualization? I'm going to go through that slide left to right. So first of all, applications that interface with the system. So applications that install device drivers. Our virtualization technology works at the user mode. It doesn't work at the kernel mode. So if you have an application that is part user mode, you know, a GUI user-facing app and a driver, we don't support virtualizing that driver. But we will actually diagnose that for you and recommend that you separate your installation into two packages. You can virtualize and deploy the user mode part of the application, and then you can take the driver part, which there's tools that you can extract those things from the install media from your vendors, or even a lot of drivers you can just install by looking at the registry configuration that they install. So the second category of applications that are a little bit troublesome are applications that use not supported extensibility points. And what are extensibility or extension points? We define as extension points basically all the pieces of the operating system that an application will want to interact with. For example, shortcuts, file extensions, you know, when you double click on a file and the operating system knows what application should receive the data of this file so it can be presented to the user. There's some extension points that we don't support out of the box. For example, shell extensions, which are a bunch of extensions that the operating system will let you, for example, override by completely the right-click context menu that comes up on a file. Also, plugins and application plugins, we support those with a technology called dynamic suite composition. And DSC solves a lot of issues. And I'm going to cover DSC in detail later. But basically, when more than one app wants to look at each other, in the case of plugins and middleware or just two apps, just they need to see each other's collateral, dynamic suite composition is what's going to create that merged virtual environment. And I'm going to cover that in detail later. The third kind of troublesome application are those applications that kind of have proprietary formats for configuration and things like that. Like, say, applications during installation, and this is a very common scenario, they will, on first launch, set up additional configuration that the application needs, and they will put machine-specific information, like file paths, into a proprietary format, a binary file or some XML file that we don't know how to decode. There's no way we can go in and decode those things, but you can deal with that by following the best practices and making your sequencing station, the machine that you're going to go produce your package, be similar configuration to the machine that actually the application are going to be deployed to. So if in the proprietary format it says C colon blah, 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 if it also says that on the client machine, there's not going to be any issues. So now I just want to jump in and do a demo. And what I have prepared for a diagnostics demo is we're going to take an application that you can get from MSDN. It's Network Monitor. I'm sure a lot of people are familiar with that app. It sniffs out the network. It tells you information about the protocols being used and the data being interchanged between computers. And it can fall into that category of applications that are require a little bit of more attention. So let me switch over here to my demo PC. And what I have here is the sequencer. It's all the preparation I have. I have a clean VM, and here's the sequencer. Before I move on, I wanted to show you and highlight all the features we've added to the system based on the customer feedback that we've gotten and the user experience. So the first thing you're going to notice is that on the landing page, I don't know if you can see my mouse over here, the sequencer is very explicit about the main two workflows supported. You can either create a virtual application package, or you can take an existing one and modify it. If you move here to the top right corner, you're going to see that we brought links to a lot of the documentation that we have online for AbbVie. And that includes posts that we've done, white papers, even information about our recipes for sequencer and stuff. And we've done the same thing for community content. If you keep flowing down into the bottom, we put links there to the forums, to the Package Accelerator's website, and I'm going to go into detail later about that. We even have our blog in there. So it's very easy for the sequencer engineer to jump back and forth from information about AbbVie. So I want to do a package. Let me go click on that. Again, the sequencer is very explicit about what's going to happen. Some of the feedback that we've heard from customers is that it's not always clear what are the steps that need to be followed to go from zero to an actually take an application and package it into a virtual application package. So you're going to see here on the left-hand side that we're very explicit about the workflow and all the steps that are going to take you to get to that package. And as you choose the selections of the things you want to do, you're going to see that we modify that because some workflows are shorter than others. In this case, the sequencer is asking me if I want to create a package or I want to use a package accelerator, which is the most awesome feature, but I'm not going to talk about it yet. So let's go ahead and create a package. So this is the first time the sequencer is going to hit you with diagnostics. Now, there's two points in time we show diagnostics to you. This first one is in preparation for you to go produce that virtual application package. So we're going to give you warnings, errors, and informational messages. Here the sequencer is giving me a warning. It's telling me that there's a service running in the background that can potentially start downloading information into my machine. Now, I don't want that extra information to go into my package, because remember, the sequencer is going to be listening on all the changes that happen during an application installation. So I'm going to see what we suggest in there, and we say, okay, just go in there and stop that service. So I'm going to do just that. Let me open MMC, and let's go stop that service. Windows Defender, stop that. Windows starts complaining because now I'm running an unsecure machine, but now let's refresh that. Okay, there's another warning. Sequencer is telling me that there's applications running. Well, the same way you wouldn't want a service like Windows Defender downloading antivirus updates in the background, you wouldn't want an application messing around with the files in the file system. So I go there, and you can see that the sequencer is even going to tell me what is the application that's running so I can go exit that application and prepare my system for a good clean sequencing. And of course, this was my fault. I left MMC running in the background. So let's go ahead and close that. Hit refresh. Nice. No more diagnostics. So what we're doing here is giving the sequencer engineer the confidence they need to know that as best as we can diagnose, they have a clean VM that's ready for them to produce a package. So I'm going to click next. And now the sequencer is asking me about the different supported scenarios that you can virtualize. There's just sequencing a new application, doing plugins. For example, you know, we have customers that have thousands of Office plugins for Word and Excel. And there's also the case of middleware. And you're going to see on the left hand of the user experience that the workflow changes depending on what is the action that you want to execute. And this was, we also heard a lot of customer feedback that virtualization is kind of similar for all kinds of scenarios, but it's also a little bit different. So we wanted to be explicit about the information that we tell the customer as they're sequencing. So I want to go do a standard application. Now the sequencer wants me to give him the installer. This is, again, an example of feedback that we get because we get customers that run into the issue where they would start running their installers before the sequencer is ready to start monitoring changes. Well, we built the sequencer. We know when it's ready. So how about you give us the installer, and we'll launch it when it's ready? So we offload that from the sequencer engineer's hands. So I'm just going to go browse to my desktop where I downloaded my network monitor installer. And you can see that you can still do your custom installations where you can copy drag and drop files and the kinds of things that you could do before. That's still in there. So now in this page, it's my initial metadata for this package. So a package name, I'm just going to call it network monitor. And one of the things that you're going to see here is that not only did the sequencer pre-populate this package root directory for the application, we no longer require an 8.3 name for the root of the package. Now, for those of you that have no idea about AppV, yeah, thank you. You might be asking yourself, what the hell is he talking about 8.3 packages? This is not 1995. Well, we had an old limitation in our technology that required the package root to be an 8.3 name. We've removed that from the sequencer, and we've even made the population of the Q drive also for the user. So you don't have to go create this directory, set up your Q drive. We will actually go create a virtual drive and hook that up for you. So if you're feeling nostalgic and you still want to do an 8.3, you can click edit and you can actually go put your little 8.3 name here. Just don't do it because we don't need it anymore. So I'm going to click next. And now the sequencer is going to go ahead and prepare for the to produce this virtual application package. Now this is, remember I said before that some users would start installing before they had a chance to, before we had a chance to start monitoring? Well, this is where we're doing all that preparation to start looking at changes in the machine. For example, we take a snapshot of the disk that we can then diff in the end and see the files that went in. So now here's the installer of network monitor. I'm gonna click yes. One thing that you're gonna notice is that some services like Windows Update, we did turn off for you so that you would be able to sequence without Windows updates running in the background. Now you might ask yourself, why didn't we do that for Windows Defender? Well, security is very important to us, and we don't want to take the decision for you to stop your antivirus from running. If you missed this little bubble that came up, it was an example of the sequencer giving you the best practices and putting them in your face so that reminded you that when you go install an application, you choose the same installation root directory that we told the sequencer before. So if you missed that pop-up, my apologies. But I'm going to remember, I'm going to go customize this installer, and I'm going to change the location to the Q drive package root that the sequencer created for me. And I'm going to click next. I'm going to accept everything. And now network monitor is going to produce with its installation. Network monitor, it's composed of both a user mode side with an application that has a GUI for you to manage all your sniffing in the network. And then it also has a second installer where it lays down the driver. So you can see it's going to be one of those troublesome applications that you have to take a little bit of extra care in order to produce a sequencing. So right now, the sequencer is actively monitoring all the changes that happen in the system. Any registry key that this application tries to lay down into the OS, we're going to capture so that we know to put it into a virtual registry with your package. You can also, during all this monitoring, if you need to install some other files or do some other stuff and put it into your package, you can actually run that at the same time. There's no incorrect sequencing of events. You can do your installations in parallel, unless there are installers that conflict. So now, while that goes in and installs a driver, this installer is going to take a little bit of time. So what I want to do is go back to my presentation and talk to you about the deployment issues we're going to hit with that package if we don't go ahead and listen to the sequencer diagnostics. The first deployment error you're going to get is that the application is going to launch, and it's going to be, hey, I'm missing this script. Where is the script? And I'm going to show you how the sequencer diagnostics actually tell me that these files were missing so I can go preemptively fix that before you actually get a call in from customer support when your user tries to actually launch the application. Another deployment error that you're going to hit with this package if I don't go and listen to the sequencer diagnostics is that it's going to complain that it can't find the driver that it needs to sniff out the network. You know, application is going to come up, hey, where's my driver? I can't learn anything about the network until you get me my driver. I'm going to show you how the sequencer helps you diagnose that as well. So let's go back to the installation, see how that's going. Okay, we got 2 seconds to go. It's been my experience with this installer that sometimes it says 2 seconds, 3 seconds, 1 second, and it can take up to a minute, but let's see what's going on. Actually, I can take a question while we wait. Does anybody have a question? Yes? Excuse me? Yes. The best practice is that you produce your package in the same OS configuration as the one you're going to deploy. There's also cases where you can actually, our best practice is to always sequence on the earlier OS. So there's applications that you're going to produce packages on Windows XP, for example, and those will run in Windows 7. But it's all very application specific. So we recommend that you do test it a little bit. And we are on the second 30 seconds of the 2 seconds now. Yes, another question over there. Can you use the microphone? I can't hear you from back there.
Aside from the Windows the sequencer disabling Windows update, is there any other kind of services that should be disabled? I saw that the sequencer did pick up when the Defender, but is there like a best practice that we should disable, you know, antivirus or anything else in particular?
Yeah. So what we recommend is that no services that you know, so we diagnose a bunch of them ourselves. Like we know a bunch of Microsoft core services that are going to be trying to pull data. So those we diagnose and we tell you about them. The best practice is that any other services that you might know that are trying to pull data like antiviruses, you should stop before sequencing. But we only diagnose what we know about.
And would you recommend if you run this on a VM, it's like pretty much that would be not persistent, so that way changes aren't always committed to whenever you reboot. If you were to install this on a workstation, for instance.
Can you repeat that again? I missed the first part.
What I'm saying is if you're sequencing something and you want to put it on, would you recommend running this on a VM where it would be not persistent? So anytime you'd reboot it, it would just delete those changes. Otherwise, I mean, I think you probably just keep the changes locally installed.
Yes, we always recommend that you sequence on a VM. And I'm going to talk a little bit about pending reboots later, and that's also something that we will diagnose and tell you about. So now I'm done, and I click that I'm done, so the sequencer knows that this application is finished installing. And now the sequencer is going to go ahead and take a look at all those changes that happened during installation. So before it started, we took a snapshot of the disk, so we knew all the files that were in the file system. And now, after installation, we're going to take another snapshot, and we're going to compare the two disks to see what, for example, all the files that got laid down by the application, because they should be pulled into the virtual application package. Yes, another question over here. We're going to get to that. The question was that in our old sequencer, we used to recommend that you launch the applications the first time so that any extra installation that happens on first launch, we grab. We're actually now very explicit about that. I'm going to show you that in a few seconds. Because we got some customer feedback that it wasn't always clear that you had to do that, so we had it written in a best practices document somewhere, but the UI didn't really make you go do that. So here we go. This is what the gentleman here was talking about, that we recommend you launch the applications and do any configuration you want to do once after sequencing. And now our UI is very explicit about doing that. So in this case, I want to run network monitor. I don't really care about launching the ULA. But you can see that here's my little app. And I'm going to close that. I'm going to keep going. So now the sequencer listens again on any changes because of all these applications that do all their installation on first launch. So now here's the second phase of diagnostics. And these are diagnostics that we know because of everything that happened during the sequencing. So the first one, it's telling me, oh my God, you have a driver. We don't support drivers. And I can double click on that, and it'll tell me exactly where this driver was configured and installed on the registry. So let me go take a look at that. I can just launch RedEdit. And let's see, what is that? System, current control set, services, NM something. And you can see that right here, I got all the configuration information for this driver installation. Now, a lot of drivers, you can just take export this registry configuration and use SC to install the driver, and that'll be a good installer. But we actually recommend you to go take out the installer from the media or ask for your vendor to separate the installers for you. We have a lot of customers whose vendors will do this for them. So, okay, I know about that problem. Now, what's the second problem? And this is an informational message. Actually, let me take a little bit of time to talk about the different types of diagnosis that you're going to get. We're going to give you warnings, like we just saw, informational messages, which you can choose to ignore, but we always recommend that you take a look at them. And then we'll also give you errors. When we actually see an error, we know that the package that you're going to produce is not going to work. So we will actually stop you, and we won't let you click next if there's any errors. So here is telling me that there were a bunch of files that got excluded. So we exclude files, and this is totally configurable because there's a lot of files that are configuration specific or files that locations that an application doesn't usually install if it provides a good installer. But so I'm going to walk the list and see what are all these files, temp, log. Okay, but wait, what about this one? Well, this application installer was a little bit more crazy, and it actually laid down some files that it needs to properly run in the user documents section. So our guidance here is that you can do two things to fix this before you deploy this package. If you're feeling like a ninja, a power user, you want to go make some craziness, you can go up until the end of producing the sequencing and click Customize, and we will actually bring up the old UI that we have that actually lets you go in, look at the virtual services, look at the virtual file system, look at the virtual registry, and add and delete information from those. So you can actually go edit the virtual file system and add this file back. But what we actually recommend to get a better success rate is that you remove this exclusion from the list of excluded locations, and you can do that in the sequencer tools menu, and actually do the sequencing again, so just to be safe. So I'm not going to do those things here for the sake of speed, but now know that we're working with a package that we're going to hit those two errors. So I want to go ahead and show you the customization you can do on the package. So see the workflow here on the left change based on my selections. So the first customization step is going to let me edit or add shortcuts that I want to publish to my users. Now, in my particular case, I don't really want all my users to have to pepper their desktop with a pointer to the ULA, so I'm going to remove that shortcut. I'm going to leave the other default shortcut in there. And now, this pane right here is very important if you're going to do streaming. Now, streaming is entirely configurable. There's some customers that actually make the applications fully cached before the launch, but streaming is a very cool technology. And with streaming, we will actually, in this streaming optimizing section, we will ask you to launch the application once. We're going to actually go inspect all the bits and binaries that the application needed for this first launch and to get into a stable state. And we're going to front load those bits in the package so that they get streamed first. So when the user goes and double clicks on that shortcut that you publish into his desktop, we're going to zoom all those binaries there really fast. So in a couple of seconds, he's going to get his application up and running. And the rest of the files are going to be background streamed. You can think of applications, for example, Microsoft Office Word, you know, just a few megs, and you can get the application up and running. But do you really need the 200 or 500 megs of font files in order to get that application launching? You don't really need it. So you can launch the application and then get all the bits there, and then the rest of the fonts will be background streamed. So I'm not going to do it here. But the sequencer is going to tell you, hey, man, are you sure you don't want to optimize this package for streaming? And I'm going to be like, I know what I'm doing, so I'm going to click yes. The target OS, this is very important. You can actually set metadata into your package to say what operating systems are supported. So I'm going to go, it's like, hey, I'm going to do XP. Oh, wait, no. Here is another example of one of those best practices popping up. We actually recommend that you sequence on the earlier version of the operating system so you can get a better chance of this package working in future versions of the operating system. Because what's going to happen if I sequence in Windows 7, there's a lot of files and a lot of updated components in the operating system that are not going to be there in Windows XP. So a Windows 7 package will not magically work on a Windows XP machine. Now, Windows Server 2008 R2 is actually based on the same kernel as Windows 7. So that one is actually okay, because they're compatible versions of the operating system. Now, just to be super clear, we don't do any magic here to make XP apps running Windows 7 or vice versa. This is all purely a deployment thing, where the AppV agent will actually reject packages that come down with metadata saying that that operating system is not supported. So I'm going to go ahead and say, hey, I want to run it in all operating systems. And now here's the last phase of sequencing. I can actually save my package now. Or I can go and modify the package, and you can go through those and edit the virtual collateral for that app, like I recommended earlier. You can take and I can add that script file to the virtual file system. You can see here that the sequencer is going to tell you what the package size is in case you want to compress it or not. In this case, it's a rather small package. I don't care about compression. I'm just going to click create, and that's going to produce a package for me. So this is the moment after the sequencer has gathered all that information about what is the collateral that this application needs to have in its package and I need to virtualize, it is actually going to take that all collateral right now and put it in a package file. So let's give that a couple of seconds. Then we can go inspect all the assets that got created. The warnings and the diagnostics, we actually pull them up one more time so you can know what you did. You know, you accepted these warnings, you accepted these informational messages, they're there for you. You're gonna see that we also take those warnings, and with the assets that we create for this package, here's all the files that were generated. Your SFT file, which is the file that's gonna contain all the binaries that make up that app, you know, the virtual file system, the virtual registry, fonts, all these things. SPRJ file, that's your project file, so you can open this package up again in the sequencer and edit it, update it. The manifest file is going to contain basically information about all the extension points that your application needs. You know, the application puts down one shortcut, you know, registers a couple of file type associations. But then there's this new report. And the report is actually going to contain a list of all the diagnostics that were found during sequencing. So you can see that if you ignored that missing NPL script file and you persisted this report file with your packages, your investigation IT guy could actually go in and say, hey, wait, but in this report, there's the diagnostic saying that that file was ignored, so we need to go in and fix this package. So we recommend that you take these reports and you actually persist them with your packages. So let me switch back to the presentation and actually recap what we've seen in this demo. Okay, so sequencing diagnostics, what have we seen? Well, we saw that there's two moments in time that we give you these diagnostics. The first one is on a prepared computer before you start your sequencing. I showed you samples of diagnostics for services running in the background, applications running in the background, but we also support other kinds of diagnostics. We will actually diagnose that your computer has a pending reboot because you don't really want to start sequencing an application when the OS is in this half-installed state. It's just not going to generate good results. We also diagnose if your VM has had previous sequencings done on that machine. For example, if you already sequenced one app and you're going to start sequencing a second one, that could potentially cause issues because most installers, what they do is when they see files that are already there that match the version that they need, they will just non-install it. So if application one installed a DLL that application two needs, the application two installer is not going to try to lay down that DLL, which means that it's not going to end up in your package, and that DLL is not going to be in your client machines. So you always want to sequence in a clean virtual machine. The second point in time that we saw that we give you diagnostics is the installation report after sequencing. So the first one, it's to make sure that I start sequencing with confidence. The second one is for you to troubleshoot or look at potential issues with your package. Now, we try to do the best we can to diagnose everything, every possible thing that could go wrong with your package. So I showed you samples of excluded files, which that informational message you're always going to get just because you configure the sequence with those exclusions. We showed you drivers. We will also put out diagnostics for complex objects. We support complex objects, but they don't get integrated outside the virtual environment. So if there's apps that depend on that complex object that was installed, you're going to have to suite that other all those other dependence apps with it. I'm going to talk about that a little bit later. We're going to diagnose system differences, and this is the case where, say, now I just did this package in Windows 7, right? If I go try to modify that package in Windows 7 SP1 or in a different business of Windows, we're going to actually warn you about that because there's mismatch configuration and state between those operating systems. We're going to troubleshoot and diagnose side-by-side conflicts. There's particular cases where apps will install side-by-side binaries that have a different architecture, 32-bit, x64, but they'll put them in the same location. So we cannot privatize them for you if they're the same, if they get put on the same location. And the diagnostic is actually going to give you information about how you can deal with that. And shell extensions, which I mentioned earlier, that are not supported, we will diagnose those as well. And as the same way we do with drivers and complex objects, we will tell you in the registry where those things were installed. So we do recommend that you test your app to make sure that those things work. And the third thing we saw is that all those diagnostics, we persist for you in a little XML file. So that's everything I wanted to tell you about sequencer diagnostics and the new sequencer experience. Now I wanted to talk about dynamic suite composition. Now, one of those two core technologies of AppV, virtualization, is built around the concept of isolation, right? You want to protect applications from each other. You want to protect the operating system from the applications. But hey, there's a lot of scenarios out there where I need one application to be able to see another. So this is why we build dynamic suite composition. And I want to talk to you a little bit about the support and the scenarios that we target for dynamic suite composition before I jump into the demo. But the features, again, is a way for me to take two or more virtual application packages and specify a dependency between them so that when they get deployed to a client at runtime, our agent is going to see that dependency, is going to load up the two packages together, and it's going to compose their virtual environments. And a virtual environment, it's basically all the virtual collateral of that app. It's its own little world, right, where it sees that it puts some files in the operating system. It sees that it has some stuff in the registry. But it's all encapsulated in that little world. And with composition, we will actually compose all those namespaces together. And by namespaces, I mean things like registry keys. If you have 10 packages suited together, and the application goes and says, I want to open key blah, we will actually go look for that key in all the virtual namespaces that came from all the 10 packages. And at the very end, we will actually go to native and try to find it. So we compose and blend those namespaces. Our main target scenarios for dynamic suite composition, you can suite together anything. Basically, just two apps need to see each other. But the main two scenarios that we have out there that we built this for are the middleware scenario. Basically, this is your runtimes and the apps that depend on those runtimes. For example, the Java runtime, and you have your Java app, or your .NET runtime, and you have your .NET app. And you need to compose these two guys together so that they can deploy and run in their middleware. And then the other big scenario is plugins. You want to do plugins for Visual Studio. You want to do plugins for Office. And then you have an Office package and a Visual Studio package and plugin packages. And then those can be composed at runtime for your plugins to work. So why do dynamic suite composition, right? Why not just jam in the .NET framework into all my managed app packages? Well, you don't want to do that, right? Dynamic suite composition will give you independent servicing of those packages. Say you do this, right? You have 100 apps, they're all managed, and you put the .NET framework on all of those 100 apps. Now out comes the latest security hotfix for the .NET framework. That means you're going to have to go edit and update each and every one of those 100 packages. You don't want that. You want one package for the .NET framework. You update that one, and then all your apps pull in that .NET framework package, and they get the benefits of the security hotfix. Same goes for deployment. If the .NET framework is 200 megs in size, and you have a particular engineer security group that needs those 100 managed applications in order to work, you don't really want to duplicate the 200 megs 100 times on his computer because that's going to put load on your network. It's going to put extra disk space requirements on the system. You want to just have one instance of that middleware package, whether it's the Java runtime or the .NET framework, and then all your different packages up in there. So the demo I'm going to do for you, let's switch back here to the demo machine, is plugins. It's one of the number one customer scenarios out there. We have large enterprises and customers that literally will suite thousands of plugins with their Office package, Excel plugins, and Word plugins for the line of business apps. So I'm going to do, a plugin for Word. And the plugin is actually this little guy right here. It's a plugin to save your Word documents as PDFs or XPS files. So before I get started, I want to make sure the dynamic suite composition workflows are very well understood. So I skipped a few steps. I'm going to talk to you about what those steps are. So the first thing you're going to do when you have to sequence a plugin is that you need a package for the system that supports that plugin, right? In my case, Office. So I already went in, and I created an Office package. I didn't want to make you sit here for 30 minutes while we watch the Office installer go and be sequenced. I know it's super entertaining, but we don't have enough time. So I produced this package ahead of time. I reverted my VM back. Of course, I persisted this package somewhere. And then the second step I've done, and let me launch the sequencer, is that this plugin actually needs to see Office on the system before the installer will run. So you can either, once you revert, you can install Office again natively, but without sequencing, so that when you sequence the plugin, it sees Office. Or we've actually built a feature to help you do this a lot faster. Here in Tools, there's this expand package to local system, and you can give it a package, and it's going to unwrap that package and all the files and all the registry stuff in it and integrate it to the system so that you can actually sequence your plugin. I also did that ahead of time. I cheated because the Office package is about 1.8 gigs, so it's going to take about 5 or 6 minutes to expand. Again, for the sake of time, I skipped that step. So just to summarize, to get here, I produced an Office package, reverted my VM, then I expanded it into the system. So now I'm ready to create a package for this little plugin guy. So I'm going to go create a package. Still can't do a package accelerator, even though I really want to. I'm just going to do create package the default way. I got no diagnostics. Wow, nice. I'm just super confident here, clicking next. And now I get to choose. The sequencer workflows are now very explicit about what are the different types of scenarios of applications you can sequence and virtualize. So I'm going to go with add under plugin. It says create a package that extends the functionality of standard applications. For example, a plugin for Microsoft Excel. So I'm going to click next. Again, it wants the installer. So let me go find that, which I put on my desktop. Now, this part of the sequencing, I actually want to take a couple of minutes to talk about here because there's a very important concept that we have to understand here. And it's the difference between the primary package and the secondary package. So the rule of thumb, and it's a very easy rule of thumb that you can always go back to, the primary package is the one that's going to contain that application that your user is going to launch. So in the case of a plugin, your primary package is just the Office package. Because the user's not going to double-click on a shortcut that opens the DLL for a plugin. He's going to double-click on a shortcut that opens winword.exe. In the case of middleware, it's a little bit different. You got your managed app, depending on your .NET framework package. So which one do you think is going to be the primary package in that one? The user is going to launch the managed app. He's not going to like double-click and launch the runtime and you know all the MS-Corelib DLLs and things like that. So in the case of middleware, the primary package is the managed, the dependent application. In the case of plugins, the primary package is the application that's going to host the plugin. So what the sequencer is asking me for here is, hey man, what is the exe that's going to host this plugin for you? So I know this is the plugin for Word, so I'm going to go browse, and since I already expanded my package, I'm going to go to the Q drive, there's the package root for Office, no 8.3 name, that's just awesome. I'm going to look for Office, and then here I got to look for winword.exe. So this guy's config file, this guy's winword.exe. So I'm going to select that, and click Next. Package name, this is the save as PDF or XPS plugin. I'm going to leave the defaults, I'm going to click Next, and the installer is going to get launched for me. So one thing that I want to show you here is that every single sequencer step, we've actually now put a little help link in there to go get information out of the link for you. Do you have a question over there? You would just choose one or the other. The reason we ask you for that is so that we can create an OSD file for you, which will launch that application. But you can produce different OSD files for the different things. Like, there's not going to be anything wrong with your package if you suite 10 plugins for 10 different Office apps with the Office package. I'm going to show you exactly how the linkage gets done afterwards, so you can see how you wouldn't need that. The question was, if I want to suite plugins for both Excel and Word, which one should I choose? And I'm going to show you later how it's OK to choose any of the two parent programs the same way. So I'm going to run my, oh, here's the little pop-up that we missed the last time. It's going to tell me, hey, Alvin, remember to use that installation root. Now, this is a time where I don't want you to panic, because you're going to notice that this plugin installer doesn't actually let me customize the installation root. And as a best practice, we tell you to use that installation root. Oh, wait. And you can see that this guy, he doesn't really care about any install root. It just tells me to continue, and it does whatever the hell it wants. Well, don't panic. It's OK. We give you that as a best practice, so you can actually save a little bit of perf, because if the installation root matches both on the sequencing station and the client system, we won't have to do redirection of that folder name. We have technology on the client side running that's going to do the redirection. So in this case, where this plugin didn't let me customize that location, we're going to put a token on it. And then this token is going to be expanded on the agent, and we're going to do the redirection for you. So I say don't panic, because it's just a little bit of perf. That's why it's in the best practices, because you get a little bit of perf. But that's OK. So I clicked OK. Now I'm finished installing. I'm going to click Next. Now the sequencer is going to do its thing, where it goes and dips the disks. It told me about some diagnostics, but I don't care about them for this demo. So I click Next. And I'm going to stop now. I don't care about customization either for this demo. So it's going to tell me it's about 1.8 megs. I don't want to compress that. I'm all good. Let's click Create. So this is going to be a very small package. The sequencer does with it lightning fast. So now, what do we have up until this point? We have an Office package. We have a plugin package. But what we're missing is the linkage between them, the dependency, right? If you don't link them together, we will never sweep them together for you. So the way, let me open Notepad here. The way two packages are suited together is by a little metadata that you put on the OSD file. The OSD file is a descriptor file that describes an exe inside your virtual application package, exes that you can launch. So in here, I want to look for the word OSD so I can show it to you. Here's a little word guy. Let me drop that into Notepad. And basically, you just put a little XML here that says dependency, and you're good to go. Well, you know, dealing with this XML manually could be a little bit cumbersome. We don't really want you to do that. Plus, Office has like 26 or 28 different OSDs. So what we've actually done is that we built a tool called the Dynamic Suite Composition Tool that ships as part of the resource toolkit for AppV 4.6 that will do that merging for you. So walking the tool left to right, it's going to go ask me, hey, where's a good location in your machine for me to scan for packages? I'm going to go, and I'm going to give it my desktop, because that's where I put all my packages. Click Done. And it's going to go scan and find all those packages. So here it found the Office one, and it found the XPS one, the PDA, the plugin one. Now it's going to ask me for my primary package. And I know my rule of thumb is primary package is that one that the user is going to launch. So I'm going to go ahead and select the Office as a primary package. And now I can put that dependency of the plugin into the Office package. Now, it can be mandatory or it can be optional. The guidance there is that if the dependency is critical for this application to work, you make it mandatory. If it is not mandatory, you're able to launch the application without the dependency in the case that you haven't published the dependency with the application. So in the case of Word, I mean, Word will run with the 1,000 plugins or without the 1,000 plugins, so I'm not going to make it mandatory. But if we were suiting the .NET framework with a managed app, you would have to make that mandatory, because there's no way the managed app is going to run without that .NET framework package. So let's save that. The tool is going to tell me, hey, are you sure I'm going to overwrite all your OSD files? I'm going to be like, yeah, sure, I trust you, because I know you're going to keep it backup, because that's a good dev practice. I'll keep it backup of the file before I edit it. So now let's go and check it out. See, there you go. I have a bunch of backups. So let's go see now that new Word, where's my Notepad? Let's go check out that new Word OSD file. And you can see that in difference from the other one, we actually now have the dependency in there. And this is going to say to the agent running on the system, when the user double clicks on that Word shortcut, he's going to go look for this package with the plugin, and it's going to load that with them together. So the user is going to get that plugin in his system. So Let me now switch back to my presentation and recap everything we've done. Over here, I am going to switch my VM to the next demo. Okay, so dynamic suite composition. Again, I want to be very clear about the workflows that we saw, because it's you're going to see, you saw how the sequencer kind of gets you to that workflow, but it's also really good to understand how the workflow goes. So very simple workflow. I sequence my primary app, and you know how to find that primary app. It's, again, the app that the user is going to launch. You revert your VM. You expand the primary app into the system. You can also install it, but we recommend expansion because it's way faster. Then you sequence the plugin, and then you link the dependencies, which you can do manually in Notepad if you're feeling like a ninja, or you can actually use the dynamic suite composition tool that's up for grabs online. So that's the workflow for plugins. The workflow for middleware, it is pretty much identical, but you're going to see that the difference is that steps 1 and 4 got inverted, because now your primary application is different. See? This is plugins. You sequence the primary app, and the plugin gets sequenced on step 4. Here you do it differently. You first sequence the middleware, which is not your primary package, because your primary package is the one that the user launches, which would be the managed app. But the reason why it's done this way for middleware is because there's no way the installer for the managed app or the Java app is going to run correctly without the Java runtime or the managed runtime being on that system. So other than that, identical workflow. You take a snapshot of your VM, you sequence the middleware, save that package off somewhere, revert to the snapshot, expand the middleware, or install it again. Again, we recommend expanding. Sequence the primary app, and then link them together in Notepad, your favorite XML editor, or the dynamic suite composition tool. So you may be asking yourself, so those two packages you told me are linked together, so the virtual environments get merged in runtime. Where do all the state changes go? Well, it all depends on the primary package. In the case of middleware, you're going to see that .NET App 1 is going to launch in the client machine. That is going to pull the .NET Framework package into it. It's going to merge those two virtual environments. Same thing's going to happen for .NET App 2. And any state changes that the application makes at runtime, you know, some registry keys, some files in the file system, they're actually going to be persisted with the .NET applications themselves. So your middleware package, it's always going to stay into its pristine condition. So any configuration changes or state changes by .NET App 1, they're going to stay with .NET App 1. The ones with .NET App 2 are going to stay with .NET App 2. So the primary package is the one that receives the state. In the case of plugins, in the right-hand side, you're going to see that when the user launches Word, the 1,000 plugins are going to load in with Word, and all the state changes that happen are actually going to be saved together with Word, with the Office package, because that's your primary package. The plugin packages themselves, they're kept clean. So that's dynamic suite composition. It's a critical functionality that you're going to need. And I showed you how, with the sequencer, we actually now make the workflow very explicit, so you can figure out what to do. So we saw diagnostics. We saw dynamic suite composition. Now it's time for package accelerators, which is the awesome new feature that I want to talk to you about. And package accelerators, they're meant to accelerate how you produce a package. Now, I am a big fan of not reinventing the wheel. I believe in making the wheel better. So when you think about a process as sequencing, and the fact that AppV has been in the market for, you know, a lot of years, there's some of these applications, and the knowledge that was developed to figure out how to put them into a virtual application package has been, you know, figured out over and over and over again across, you know, all of our customers, across our in-house, for specific applications. If you take an application like Microsoft Office or Visual Studio, some of these applications, Adobe Reader, they're critical to a lot of companies. So a lot of these companies separately went in and figured out how to sequence these applications. Now, what if I tell you we could build a feature that takes all this knowledge that somebody else learned, put it in a little box, you take your installer media that you get from your vendor, the Adobe Reader installer, the WinZip installer, you put it in the little box, You shake them together, you don't have to do any installation, you don't have to do any monitoring, and out comes a virtual application package. Well, that's what package accelerators are. And before I go into all the technical details behind them, I'm just gonna jump into the demo and show you how different the sequencer workflow is gonna be for sequencing with a package accelerator. So let me switch back to my demo laptop. So what I have here is just a clean VM, and I have a package accelerator. The package accelerator is just a cap file. You can double click and open that. The package accelerator, if you will, it is a template on how to produce a virtual application package. It is what we internally we like to call a dehydrated package. So it's basically a package that has all the knowledge about the package, except all of the intellectual property, all the binaries that come with that application. The only interesting thing you're gonna see in there is there's also this README file. And I'm gonna show you what this README file is all about. This README file is meant to be a template on guidance on how to use this package accelerator. And we have that integrated with the sequencer workflow. So I'm not gonna open it there and cheat. I'm gonna show you how the whole experience and the workflow feels like end-to-end in the sequencer. So let me launch my sequencer. The only other thing I have here on my desktop is the Adobe Reader installer, which I downloaded from our friend's Adobe website. So I'm gonna create a new virtual application package. Now I get to do a package accelerator. And look at how the number of steps have decreased on the left-hand side. It's pretty awesome. It's gonna be super fast, painless creation of a virtual application package. Sequencer is asking me for the package accelerator. I'm just gonna browse to my desktop and find that. Now, these package accelerators, they're cap files, so they can actually be digitally signed. So the sequencer will actually give you a warning if you try to use a package accelerator that's not digitally signed. You wanna make sure you get your package accelerator from a trusted location, the same way you do your installers. So here's that README file. So it's the packaging and deployment guidance, and this was produced by the person who authored the package accelerator and published it. It tells you what operating systems were supported, what's the version of the application that it's meant to drive. And it also tells you anything, any extra information you might need in order to deal with this package accelerator. This is just a rich text file. We do provide a template for the creation of these files. And you can actually export them. You can take this RTF out of the package accelerator and put it in your second monitor if you want to like read it while you do the sequencing. The only important tidbit of information that it's telling me here is that what we got from Adobe was an EXE, but what I need is the install media. So it's telling me that our friends at Adobe were nice enough to actually provide functionality in their EXE to extract the media out. So I'm gonna open a command prompt. Just go to my desktop there and paste that command line in. And what that's gonna do, it's gonna take all the media out of the EXE. Now, there's no industry standard on how to take, you know, MSI files, CAP files, installation media, and wrapping it into an EXE. So we're not able to do this part for you, but you're gonna see that this is the only effort that the sequencer engine is gonna need to put in. Everything else will do for you. So that has been extracted. Here it is on my desktop. I'm gonna click next. Installation files, okay. I just did that, let me put it there. And the accelerator actually knows which apps it's expecting, so it's telling me, hey man, I expect to find Adobe Reader 9.4 there. I'm gonna be like, oh yeah, well that's what I put in there, so it should all just work. So I click next, even gives me a default name. Any comments, for example, don't forget to use Windows 7, blah, blah, blah. This package accelerator actually told the sequencer that it wants to be compressed because it can be pretty large. So I'm gonna go create, and that's it. Sequencer right now is looking inside that package accelerator. It is pulling out all the knowledge on how to extract all the files that it needs to package from the installation media itself, and then taking all this knowledge out so we can produce a virtual application package. Now, while that goes along, there's a couple of things I wanted to tell you. It is our intention to publish package accelerators for all the most popular Microsoft applications. That site is live. We already have accelerators in there for Microsoft Office. On the first few days since it went public, it's already been downloaded hundreds of times. It's a very popular application. We will also publish package accelerators for third-party applications that are super popular amongst our customers, like Adobe Reader. And it's also a community effort where different ISVs and different companies, they can publish their package accelerators for other people to use. So I'm going to click Next. I don't need to configure software. You know, you can do configures like optimize for streaming, target OSs, all those configuration steps that I did previously with Network Monitor. I'm not going to do them for this demo. I'm just going to click Next. And then now the sequence is going to take all of that information it figured out about how to extract the files from the media into a virtual application package and go do just that. This will take a few seconds. Take all those files out, put them in the package. Yeah, there's a question? You can upgrade it, however, the same way you would upgrade any other package. With the package accelerator. Yeah. You could also, I don't have a demo for it, but with the sequencer, you can create package accelerators. And you can create package accelerators for all the versions of the software if you think it's changed, or if it's forwards compatible, you can keep using the same package accelerator as well. So a couple of diagnostics. I don't really care about them for this demo, so I'm going to click Close. And that's it. I have all the default assets that I expect from sequencing Adobe Reader, but I had to read no recipe. I didn't have to take a look at any diagnostics. I trusted in this package accelerator that this other wonderful company in the ecosystem has published for us, whether it was a third party, whether it was Microsoft. They shared the knowledge with us, and I didn't have to reinvent the wheel. So everything is in there. Let me now go back to my slides and talk about this whole package accelerator thing a little bit more deeply. So what did we saw? What was the workflow for package accelerators? You have your sequencer. You get a package accelerator from a trusted location. Now remember, they can be digitally signed. Just the same way you wouldn't take an MSI from the web and running in all your end user machines. I mean, you would do some testing beforehand. You wouldn't do it for a package accelerator. So you procure the media, and we support MSI, SIP, CAP files, just a bunch of files in a folder. You procure a package accelerator. And what a package accelerator contains inside, as I said, it's like this dehydrated version of an IB package that is just missing all the files. And there's maps in there to tell us how to get the files from the media. We have the OSD files. We have the project files, manifests, and these kinds of things. Now, we also have something that is called ingredient files, this guy right here. And I'm going to talk a little bit more about ingredient files in the next slide. But basically, ingredient files are any file that the application needs that is not contained in the installer. Like, remember I've mentioned before that there's a lot of these nasty applications that don't do all their configuration and installation with the installer. They actually have a first launch installation. Well, files that get laid down on a first launch are files that we collect as ingredient files. And we only collect files that have no intellectual property from the vendors, basically anything that didn't come from source code and got compiled. So you take those two things, you put them in a little box, you shake it, and then out comes an IB package, as easy as that. You don't have to develop any of that knowledge in-house. So this ingredient files, I want to talk about them a little bit more. So let's just talk about how IB harvests those files out of the media. So we get the install media. We don't need to do any monitoring. We don't need to do any installation. We support all these file formats, and the only thing that we can do for you, as I said before, is that there's no industry standard for how to package install media into .exe executable files. That's the only logic that you would have to do yourself, and as the best practice goes, the README of the package accelerator will tell you exactly how to do this. So there's a little problem that you can run into, and your README file will tell you about it. There's also cases of even more evil installers that not only did they not complete their installation with the media, they did it on first launch, but the installation they completed on first launch actually has intellectual property of the vendor. So it actually has binary files in there, every stuff that came from source code. Now, we can't repackage and publish that because it belongs to another vendor. So to solve that problem, we created a feature called local installation files where we will actually, still no monitoring required, but then you are going to have to do an installation so that we can actually go in and crawl those files out of the installation. And if you're going to run into a case of this, the package accelerator README is actually going to tell you about it and tell you exactly how to do it. So we get monitoring-less sequencing, and we get installation-less sequencing unless the application is a little evil and puts down intellectual property containing files during the first launch. But most of the cases, that's not going to happen, so you really do get an installation-less packaging. So to summarize package accelerators, you procure a package accelerator, make sure it's from a trusted location, our website, your internal website of the knowledge you've built, a vendor that you know and you care about and you work closely with. You follow the guidance on the README file. It's pretty straightforward. You convert that into a package with a sequencer, and then you configure if you want to. That's all there is to it. It's meant to accelerate the way you can sequence applications. Now, having looked at diagnostics, dynamic decomposition, and package accelerators, I want to take a couple of minutes to talk about features we put in for automation. And this is going to be super fast. The first one is project templates. Project templates is a way for you to package your default sequencer configuration. So your exclusion files list, whether you need compression, the target platforms. If you have the same input that you always configure your sequencer as, you can actually now export that into an XML file using a command in the tools menu. And you can share that amongst the sequencer engineers in your company. So it's a good way for you to take your own best practices and package them and share them. It's kind of the same thing as if you go into Word, you create a document, and you save that as a template that you can later apply to other documents. Well, this is the sequencer project template that you can then apply to other projects. And then you can pass it in on the command line when you launch the sequencer. Really useful feature for automation. Now, the other functionality that we added for automation is that, remember that whole step of taking an application and optimizing it for streaming? We didn't support doing that through the command line when you do the full automated sequencing case. Now we actually do, and we give you a couple of options. You can actually specify that, tell us to launch all the shortcuts that show up with the application and just let it sit there to stabilize, you know, finish loading all its DLLs and things like that for a specified period of time with that /optimize/uptime. Or you can actually pass us a script that we will run for you if you have some pre-canned steps and configuration that you want to do in your app. You know, you launch it, you make sure you run this functionality. Maybe you do care about the 500 megs in fonts that Word uses, so you go select all the fonts so that we actually capture for you that all these files are needed. And we will go ahead and do that launching for you. So that's it for automation. To just recap the whole session, we talked about these four pillars that we kind of bounded ourselves to when we did the project of the sequencer SP1 release. We have diagnostics. They help you preemptively avoid the issues instead of having to spend time investigating after deployment, things like that. With ease of use, now we have very explicit workflows in the application UI itself to make complex tasks like dynamic suite composition super easy. And predictability. Now you can actually leverage the knowledge that's out there on how to produce all these virtual application packages without having to do a monitoring session, and in most cases, without having to do an installation. And then in the end, I show you a little bit of the features around automation to help you streamline your processes as much as you can to produce these virtual application packages. Now, when can I get all these sequencer goodness? Well, it actually just shipped. It shipped a few months ago, March 11. You can actually get SP1 from the website, and this will give you the new sequencer. It's in Microsoft Download Center, MSDN, TechNet. Also, the Package Accelerators website is live, so you can go in and start downloading those accelerators for the applications that you care about. You can also contribute to the project by sharing your own package accelerators. And before I step down and I take questions, I wanted to highlight some of the related session content. There's four, we're four people from the product team that are actually here for TechEd. Kevin is going to do a presentation actually right after this one for how to set up the your infrastructure for VDI and RDS, and it's actually going to show some demos of virtual applications running on a client, you know, how virtual applications run on a server, the provisioning and stuff. Ben, Derek did a session this morning on the sister of AppV. It's called Server AppV. It's going to ship as part of System Center Virtual Machine Manager, and just picture the same virtualization that we do for desktop apps, but for server types of applications, right? So virtualizing a website, virtualizing server applications. And you can, if you miss that, you can catch it out online. And then tomorrow, Ben is going to be talking about how to deploy an effective server infrastructure backing up at V that scales. We have customers that require a huge scale. Like, you know, they'll have 15,000 applications to provision across 2,000 clients and things like that. Well, we learned a lot of things about what are the most effective ways to deploy AppV, so you can catch Ben's session. You can also find me later in the Microsoft Desktop Virtualization booth. It's around the Windows 7 client area. There's going to be several people there from other MDOP products, Microsoft Desktop Optimization Pack, which is the shipping vehicle for AppV. And I'm going to be there. You can come around. Bunch of resources to track online about tech ed, more and more resources. Don't forget to go fill out some surveys. You can give feedback on presentation style, content. Was there any other content you wanted to see? Do you like my hairstyle? You don't hate it? You can go give us feedback about anything you want. And it's a win-win situation because you actually participate to win some goodies. So